progress on this question.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. We move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 4456 in the name of Iain Gray on the Scottish Government and Education, 10 years of letting down teachers, parents and pupils. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Iain Gray to speak to and move the motion. Mr Gray, 13 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Too often, when we debate education in general and schools in particular, I think we forget the historical context. The truth is, this Parliament and this Government's responsibility for the education of our children and grandchildren sits at the front of a long and broad historical sweep. It is 500 years since the Reformation, which in Scotland especially had the revolutionary idea of universal schooling running through it. It is 145 years since attendance at school became compulsory. 50 years since Circular 600 comprehensivised our schools and ended the 11 plus. 35 years since standard grades heralded assessment for all. And 15 years since the launch of the National Debate on Education, which led to Curriculum for Excellence. And it is 10 years since this SNP government assumed responsibility for our schools. That responsibility did not begin when Nicola Sturgeon became First Minister, nor when John Swinney became Education Secretary. It spans all of the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence in schools. It covers a fifth of the history of comprehensive schools in this country. A whole cohort of pupils has almost completed their whole schooling under the SNP. So it is right and reasonable then to take this moment to judge the government's record on education, as they have invited us to do, but to judge that record of the past decade. And I suppose, in a way, the government motion or amendment this evening, it tries to do that too. And there's not much to actually disagree with in it. The trouble is, it is ridiculously partial. Above all, it fails to mention the repeated evidence of slipping standards in literacy, numeracy and science from the government's own literacy and numeracy surveys, their own improvement framework data, and most dramatically, of course, the OECD PISA results. It acknowledges challenges, but it ignores failures. Take the positive destination figures of this week that the motion references. Yes, it is welcome that more young people leave school for a positive destination, but we cannot turn a blind eye to the fact that children from poorer families are still three times more likely not to be in education, training or work than their richer counterparts. Now, the SNP put out a press release this week on these figures, somewhat inappropriately featuring the convener of the Education Committee. I have it here. He welcomes the figures briefly, as you would expect. He then spends two-thirds of his quote denouncing schools in England. The release is completed with a link to the Scottish figures and six links to information on English schools. For that whole sweep of the history of our schools, we have aspired not even just to have the best schools in the world.
Not across the chamber, gentlemen, not across the chamber. Sorry.
We have aspired not even just to have the best schools in the world, but the best we can imagine. Now it seems the government's benchmark is less bad than England. Is that really the level of aspiration the party of government sets for what the First Minister called her sacred responsibility?
Bill Paterson.
In Scotland, then. And I wonder if you're aware that West Dunbartonshire Council cut the school week by half a day. And it had to be reversed by the opposition calling a special meeting. So what does that do for the poorest people? Every school in West Dunbartonshire qualifies for additional funds. So what do you say about Scotland and the way that your party treats education?
Iain Gray.
Well, to tell you the truth, when it comes to cutting the school day, what I remember best is the massive public meeting in Renfrew Council when it was run by the SNP, which I attended, to support the parents who were fighting exactly that. Listen, Curriculum for Excellence is exactly about setting our sights higher, freeing our teachers to teach, inspire and innovate to the maximum. You know, the Education Secretary occasionally asks me if we in these benches still support curriculum for excellence. And we do. It is exactly because we support it that it pains us to see the mess this government has made of its implementation. Because the decade of CFE implementation has been a decade of cuts to school budgets, over 4,000 fewer teachers, over 1,000 fewer support staff, and class sizes steadily increasing. I heard the Education Secretary yesterday say that last year spending on schools increased, and it did. But the same figures show that it is that school budgets are still hundreds of millions of pounds lower in real terms than they were in 2007 when the SNP came to power. One swallow does not a summer make, nor one year undo a decade of cuts. In any case, the government have achieved the remarkable feat of losing thousands of teachers' jobs and creating a teacher shortage at the same time. The Education Secretary, I heard him say a few minutes ago, has increased teacher training places, but universities struggle to fill them.
Mark MacDonald.
To Iain Gray for giving way, and he cites teacher shortages, and I wonder whether he feels it's sensible, therefore, for Labour-led Aberdeen City Council to have written out to teachers offering them voluntary severance or early retirement when at the same time complaining of a teacher shortage.
Iain Gray.
Listen, every council in the country is labouring under the strain of £1.5 billion of cuts they've suffered from the past few years. But Mr Swinney likes sometimes to accuse us of being to blame for all this shortage, that we talk teachers down. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm a teacher to trade, and you won't catch me talking teachers down. I know that a fully trained professional teaching force has always been the greatest strength in our schools. And I know that in spite of those cuts, they deliver remarkable success and inspire our children every day of the week. We should thank them. But if we keep cutting them, those thanks are worthless. The fact is that we pay teachers less than similar countries do. We provide them with less preparation time than other countries do. We provide them with less support staff and resources than other countries do. And we put them in front of bigger classes than pretty well every other country in the developed world. And then we wonder why we can't recruit enough of them. Thanking teachers means nothing unless we listen to their concerns. The Education Committee of this Parliament did just that. They listened to teachers. And teachers told them they'd lost confidence in the SQA and in Education Scotland, that reductions in additional support staff were making life difficult. And the Education Secretary rubbished the work of the committee. It wasn't a proper sample, he said. And then he told the committee the valid view is what teachers told him when he visited schools. I'm reminded of the old chestnut that the Queen thinks the world smells permanently of fresh paint. And now we hear that the Cabinet Secretary has delayed his governance reforms, but he's not listening again. The responses to that review tell him that the reforms it proposes miss the point. Here's the EIS, here's teachers. The greatest barrier is and has been the imposition of austerity-driven budgets and the underfunding of the Scottish education system over the past period. But it's not just teachers. Here's a group of parents from Aberdeen. Local council budgets have been reduced year on year for a considerable number of years. Teacher shortages impact the ability to deliver excellence and equity for all. Or here's Dundee Council, run by the SNP. They say the real barriers have been imposed on councils over recent years following a series of past and present reductions to the budget. The Royal Society for Edinburgh sums it up neatly. It is not clear how the proposed governance changes will lead to improved educational experiences and outcomes. Isn't the real reason government have delayed their great reforms is that their response is telling them they are the wrong reforms, and what is actually needed in our schools is more resource, more teachers, and more time. And there's little or no support either for plans to centralise school budgets. Now, Mr. Swinney sometimes asks me if we support anything he does. Well, we do. We support the Equity Fund to close the attainment gap. Why wouldn't we? From the moment the attainment fund was introduced, we said it should be more, it should follow pupils to whichever school they attend. We even argued free school meal entitlement was the best proxy for poverty, and that funds should go direct to head teachers. And the government clearly agreed, because that's what they've done. But we can't ignore the fact that this is £120 million set against cuts of £170 million to councils' core budgets. And we can't ignore the fact that this is £120 million of funding devolved to schools set against the core school budgets being removed from local control and set centrally by formula. That's £120 million devolved and £4 billion centralised. To paraphrase the First Minister, only in the world of the SNP could that be called decentralisation, not centralisation. You know, in my constituency, there's a primary school with over 1,000 pupils, one of the biggest in the country. And there's others just down the road with less than 20. The idea that some algorithm in Victoria Quay will know enough about those schools and the communities they serve to make a rational decision on their budget is ridiculous. It is not serving the interests of parents, the schools, the teachers, to remove local control of their budgets, any more than it serves their interest to cut teacher numbers, reduce support staff, and increase class sizes. Yes, our schools need reform. But we need reforms that take teachers and parents with us. Even the Education Secretary's core reform of national standardised assessment. We tried to maintain an open mind on that. But he's failed to take teachers with them. That's why we see the vast majority of councils saying they're going to use those assessments on top of what they did before. Increasing workload, increasing testing. And that's why we've seen those leak tables we were promised we wouldn't see. And the defence that the Scottish Government don't publish the leak tables, they just publish the numbers that somebody can put them in order, is just ridiculous. Yes, our schools need reform. The new exams need reform because they're narrowing the curriculum and reducing attainment. Local charging for exam remarks, that needs reform, that should end. The senior phase needs reform, backed by a comprehensive career guidance system. And achievement could be universally acknowledged, maybe through a Scottish graduation certificate. Every school should have a counselling service available and a breakfast club. There should be more collaboration, yes, between schools within and across education authorities. The SQA certainly needs reformed, refocused and resourced. The inspectorate should be independent again. Education Scotland should be serving teachers, not ministers. And it could perhaps provide that strengthened middle the OECD suggests we need if it was regionalised. But above all, our schools need more teachers with more support, more time and more resources to do the job they do so well. That's the core reform. Failure to deliver it is the defining characteristic of the SNP decade in charge of education. Don't delay your reform programme, Education Secretary. Ditch it now and start investing properly in schools. That's what parents and teachers and SNP councillors are telling you too.
Thank you. I don't think you moved your motion. I don't think you moved your motion, Mr. Gray. I may have missed it. Did you move it?
Sorry.
Thank you very much.
Firmly moved.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, 8 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I move the amendment that stands in my name. Iain Gray said that it was right and reasonable to hold the government to account, and of course that is correct. The government is here to be held to account, and I accept that accountability. But there's also a need for all parties to be consistent. And Iain Gray's criticism of my amendment was that it was ridiculously partial. And my amendment acknowledges that despite the progress that's been made, and I'll come back to the progress, there remains significant challenges in closing the attainment gap and raising standards for all. It further acknowledges the wider challenges that exist within Scottish education, including budget pressures, the wider impacts on poverty, on educational opportunity, teacher recruitment, teacher workload, and the role of agencies such as the SQA and Education Scotland. That, to me, is a fair assessment of Scottish education. And when I look at what Iain Gray has put down, what I see Iain Gray putting down on the order paper today is a motion which says absolutely nothing good about Scottish education, nothing whatsoever. It is a disgraceful motion, yeah, Mr Gray, for you to have put down in Parliament today. And I utterly refute, the characterisation of Scottish education. I utterly refute the characterisation. Now, if Mr Gray made reference to schools in his constituency, I refuse to believe that if he went into Knox Academy or Dunbar Grammar School or North Berwick High School or Ross High School or Preston Lodge High School, he would find a characterisation as pathetically miserable as in his motion that he's got before Parliament today. Yes, if he wants to give way, shall
Iain Gray?
I go into all of these high schools on a regular basis. And do you know what they tell me, Mr Swinney? They tell me they ain't got enough teachers and they can't recruit to teachers for the vacancies they have. That's what they tell me.
Cabinet Secretary.
And what those schools will also tell Mr Gray, what they'll tell Mr Gray, well, Mr MacDonald is shouting I should answer the point. I've answered in the amendment the points of issue about teacher recruitment and about workload and about other issues. But what Mr Gray's miserable motion fails to do is take account of the fact that we have a record number of advanced higher passes in this country. We have a record, the second highest level of achievement in the higher qualification. We have a rising number of positive destinations achieved by young people in Scotland as a product of the education system. What's stopping Mr Gray putting some of that on the record to complement what our teachers and our pupils are able to achieve in Scottish education? What's wrong with celebrating what's actually achieved in the schools of Scotland? Give way to Mr MacDonald.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm grateful to Mr Swinney for taking the intervention. He mentioned teacher training and teacher recruitment. That is precisely the crisis that is facing local authorities across the north of Scotland. He referred to that in answer to Richard Lockhead earlier. All that he has done in the last 6 years has failed to address that teacher recruitment crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we've brought forward 11 new mechanisms to encourage teachers to join the teaching profession. We increased the postgraduate diploma in education intake by 19% last year. I've increased the intake by 370 teachers this year. And for my efforts, Aberdeen City Council wants to offer teachers voluntary redundancy. How is, in any way, is that a sensible step for Aberdeen City Council to be taken? Now, the government has set out in the National Improvement Framework an agenda for strengthening Scottish education from the foundations that we have. And I'm first to accept, as I have accepted in the government's amendment, that there are challenges that exist within Scottish education. And there's an opportunity for political parties in this parliament to have an opportunity to work with the government in taking forward the agenda and in contributing positively to that agenda. But what concerns me about the characterisation of Scottish education that we've heard from Mr Gray today is the unwillingness to acknowledge the strength of performance that has been achieved. Whether that's the 30% increase in higher passes since 2007, or the increase to 93.3% of positive destinations of young people leaving education, or the fact that 9 out of 10 young people from deprived communities are now continuing in education, and the gap between those young people from deprived backgrounds able to achieve qualifications at SCQF level 5 has declined from 36.8% to 20.9%. That's the achievement that's been made in Scottish education. I don't understand why Mr Gray won't celebrate it.
Iain Gray.
I think Mr Swinney would have to acknowledge that this was something I did celebrate, successes within Scottish education, in my speech. The point he misses, of course, is that the motion is about his and his government's stewardship of Scottish education. Scottish education is succeeding in spite of his failures and not because of his successes. He's yet to tell us one of his successes.
I'll just
go through it again in case Mr Gray didn't hear it. Well, since 2007, this government came to office in 2007 and we have got a 30% increase in the higher pass rate. This government has seen an increasing year-on-year delivery of 93.3% in positive
destinations. I'd like to hear all speeches, please. Thank you.
And these achievements have been made, yes, by the young people of Scotland in an education system over which this government has been presiding. And that is what Mr Gray has got to accept as part of this process. And on his point about his speech recognises all of these things, ask Mr Gray to go and look at the miserable motion he has put forward, which characterises Scottish education in an unrepresentative fashion that does not account for the progress that has been made in Scottish education, and that's what Mr Gray has got to take account
of. The member's in his last minute. I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary, you're in your last minute.
Okay, President Officer. Let me conclude on some of the measures the government is taking to address these issues. The government has put forward £120 million of the pupil equity funding directed schools in Scotland to ensure that schools have got the ability to take into account the circumstances of young people to boost their educational attainment and their education possibilities. The Scottish Attainment Fund puts £50 million directly into 9 local authorities with high levels of deprivation, and the government support is in place to maintain the number of teachers at 51,000 in the schools of Scotland able to contribute to the quality education of young people in Scotland. That is what the government is doing. Now, I'm interested in having a debate about how we strengthen Scottish education, but we have to have that debate from the standpoint of what is being achieved already in Scottish education. And after a process of reform, Scottish education is performing at a higher level in terms of those achievements of positive destinations, of higher passes, of advanced higher passes. That is what has been delivered as a consequence of our efforts in Scottish education. What we are determined to do is to ensure that we improve that performance consistent with the National Improvement Framework, to work with schools and with local authorities to achieve that. And what would help us is if the opposition in Parliament would engage in a constructive debate rather than carping from the sidelines, which is exactly what Mr Gray has done today.
Cabinet Secretary, can I get you to move your amendment, please? I now call Liz Smith. Ms Smith, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start, I hope, on a constructive note, because I think that Mr Gray is correct in some of his analysis. I also think the Cabinet Secretary is correct in some of his analysis. And that exchange just now actually flags up what I think is a deeper problem. And it's not to do with who's right and who's wrong, but it's about the nature of the evidence by which we make our judgments. And that was something that came through very strongly at the Education Committee this morning, but it's something that's been coming through a lot of the studies that have been done on Scottish education. And one of the base problems that we face, and this was picked up by the OECD, it's been picked up by some of our education experts, is that in order to get a value judgment, because that's what we're all looking for, and I don't doubt the integrity of every single member in this chamber to do what is best for Scottish education, but to get a value judgment, we need to be absolutely clear that the base evidence that we have is both relevant and that it's accurate. And one of the great sadnesses about the Curriculum for Excellence is that that evidence wasn't taken at the appropriate time. So it's very difficult for us to then measure the progress that is being made, or in some cases, the lack of progress that is being made. And I think that this judgment is crucial, because if we are going to do what's right for Scottish education, which will bind together some of the points that Mr Gray has made, and obviously that the Cabinet Secretary has made, that evidence is absolutely crucial. And can I just bring it back to the committee evidence? Because we've been criticised as a committee that some of the judgments that we've been made has not been formulated around a wide enough base of evidence, and that it's been unbalanced. And in some cases, perhaps it hasn't given due credibility to some of the other people who've been involved in that debate. Now, I worry about that, because I think one of the most important things in this Parliament is the committee system and the way that we do scrutinise what is going on. And I give credit to our current chairman, who I think has had a very difficult job in trying to marshal the evidence, because the reason that we've had to put a lot of our value judgments on what teachers are saying to us, both through the very formal evidence that we've taken as a committee, but also the evidence that we've had in very private focus groups, and all the evidence that we collect as MSPs when we go around the schools, we've had to listen to these teachers in great number, and to all the associations that represent them, whether that's the geography teachers, the Modern Studies Association, the computing experts, people in the unions, it doesn't matter. We've had to listen to them because a lot of the other part of the research base hasn't been there. And so that makes a lot of the judgment quite difficult. So when it comes to making our assessment of where we stand on the curriculum for excellence just now, there of course are very good things going on in Scottish education. Of course there are. And that's something that we need to recognise. And can I just say incidentally that just before I came into the chamber just now, I just heard about the Royal Conservatoire becoming third in the world for the best performing royal, the performing arts. That's a tremendous accolade for Scottish education, and we should all recognise that. But let's not detract from the main motion, and I think Mr Gray is absolutely right to flag up a lot of the great difficulties in Scottish education just now. And the Cabinet Secretary, particularly when the PISA results came out, he had good grace to acknowledge the extent of the challenge that we face. But let's just deal with the extent of that challenge, because, my goodness, it is extensive. Because the PISA scores show us exactly where we have to go to ensure that we are bringing up Scottish education, not just, may I say, for those in the lower attainment group, but for those in the higher attainment group as well. It's not just about closing the attainment gap, it's about raising the whole level of Scottish education. And we know from the PISA scores exactly how much we have to do. We also know that we have problems in teacher recruitment, well spelt out by the Labour Party this afternoon. And we learnt last week that we have serious shortages in key subjects like English and maths. That's a serious worry for Scottish education. Of course.
Neil Findlay.
That the closure of the undergraduate primary teaching degree course at Edinburgh University will be a further hindrance to recruiting teachers into Scottish education.
Liz Smith.
Yes, I do, actually. I think there are serious concerns around that, and I think that's an area that has to be looked at. In fact, I think, and I know the Cabinet Secretary has initiated new discussion about routes into teaching and the way in which we undertake the professional training of these new recruits. But there are serious questions around that, because, let's be honest, the teacher shortages are very serious, and I think our colleague Richard Lockhead referred to that in committee this morning. These are serious concerns for Scottish education just now, and we must not shy away from them. Because I think that if we do shy away from them, if we pretend that the evidence isn't accurate or that there's a way that we can get around this, we are not going to deal head on with what the Curriculum for Excellence is supposed to be doing. Now, we all agree, and I will put on record the Conservative support for the principles of the Curriculum for Excellence, but at present, I don't believe that it is being delivered particularly well. And I come back to the point, and I'll finish on this point, I come back to the point that we had throughout our committee sessions in November and December, where the education agencies found it very difficult indeed to give us cast iron reasons as to why certain decisions had been taken. For me, that's a worry, because I want to know, even if I disagree with them, I want to know why they've taken these decisions. Because if we don't know why they've taken the decisions, we're never going to be able to make progress on the way forward. And that, Cabinet Secretary, I think is one of the most important challenges that we face just now, is dealing with as education agencies and ensuring that they are taking not only the right decisions, but they're basing it on the accurate evidence that we all know we are trying to collect. And so for that reason alone, we have to do something positive about ensuring that the delivery of the Curriculum for Excellence meets the aspirations of all those teachers who are doing a fantastic job against very difficult circumstances, and of parents and of pupils. I think I'm about to finish.
Members in our last minute.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate. Can I ask all members who want to take part in the debate to make sure they press the request to speak buttons? And I call firstly Monica Leonard, followed by Jenny Gilruth. It's a tight 6 minutes to everyone, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to take the opportunity to raise an issue I've raised several times before with the Scottish Government, and that is the situation faced by our pupils with additional support needs and our vital support staff in schools. We know, because parents tell us, that we face a situation where a number of pupils require additional support needs has more than doubled since 2010, and at the same time, the number of support staff has gone down. The Scottish Children's Services Coalition have warned that we face a lost generation of children with support needs, additional support needs. And just last week, the Association of Head Teachers and Deputies made a submission to the Education Skills Committee warning that teachers do not have sufficient resources to deal with the increasing demand. Now, I know that ministers are always quick to tell myself and others in the Chamber when we raise such issues that the reason for the large increase in numbers is down to changes in the way additional support needs are calculated. That's something, of course, I do acknowledge and understand. But since we now have better data and a better understanding of the additional support needs that our pupils have, surely that would mean that we should be seeing an increase in the number of additional support needs staff and not a decline. The argument I've heard time and time again in the Chamber from ministers that the large increase in additional support needs numbers is down to sometimes temporary support needs does not mean that this is a justification for the fact that support staff in our schools has been falling year on year. Not only do we have a reduction in the number of support for learning teachers since 2010, we also have 4,000 fewer teachers overall, as Iain Gray has set out, and 1,000 fewer support staff since this SNP government came to power. And that is the record that we're looking at today. This means that the overall team it takes to keep the school running on a day-to-day basis, from librarians to cleaning staff to teaching assistants, has been much reduced over the last few years, piling more and more pressure on teachers and making any other subsequent misguided plans about school governance reform all the more difficult to implement when the basic resources for pupils and their needs are being consistently cut back. The Unison report, Hard Lessons, which was published a month or so ago, sets this out very clearly. It surveyed 900 support staff in our schools. If our teachers are telling us that they do not have the resources they need to cope with additional learning needs, then this government needs to listen to them and those concerns and use the powers of this parliament to reverse some of these cuts to local authorities, which I know people want to deny. And I will put on record my interest as an elected member in South Lanarkshire Council, but also as a parent and as an elected person who listens to people. And in fact, I've just written down a Twitter DM that came through from a parent. I don't know where he lives, but he says, "My son has an autism diagnosis and arranging necessary support in education and health is a constant battle for us. And I know it's the same for parents across the country." So he doesn't care the political colours in the local authority. The point is the resources are missing. Gladly.
Minister.
Grateful to Monica Lynn for giving way. And she raises the issue, as she has done before, about resources to local authorities. And for 10 years, we were told by Labour politicians in this chamber and in local authorities that what we needed to do was to unfreeze the council tax and free local authorities up to raise revenue at local level. We've done that. Come on, Monica Lynn, and tell me what her local authority in South Lanarkshire did and what other Labour-led councils did in relation to the council tax.
Monica Lennon.
I'm not going to waste time talking about things that are on the public record. I would have hoped Mark McDonald would have said something about the parent who texted in to tell us about their experience. And the council tax hasn't been frozen anywhere because council bills will be rising. But the point is, we're here to discuss. Point your finger at all you
no,
like,
Minister.
Minister, let's talk about how
stop
we
a minute,
actually...
Excuse me. Sit down a minute. That's not suitable.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let's talk about the attainment gap. Attempting to close the attainment gap, this government's attainment gap, will only continue to be made more difficult if the focus and attention of our classroom teachers is being constantly divided and stretched because of pressure to meet additional support needs without the help to do so. More resources in our schools support children's mental health and wellbeing is part of the broader picture around resources, and I've been asking the Mental Health Minister, who we welcome and recognise that post is an important one, but we have a delayed mental health strategy, and I've been asking you know, is the Mental Health Minister working with the Cabinet Secretary, working with the education team, not to point fingers, but to actually find some solutions? And I await a reply from the First Minister from a few weeks ago. Because every young person with additional support needs deserves the help they need to allow them to succeed and receive the education to which they are entitled. Behind all these statistics that we can all mention are young people struggling to receive the education they deserve because of a lack of resources and teachers struggling to keep up with demand. Recently, I heard from a young carer who has a younger brother with significant additional support needs who attends a special school. This young woman told me that because of staffing cuts at the school and an escalation of her brother's needs, he's now sent home from school after lunchtime every day, meaning not only is he missing out on his full educational entitlement, but there's increased pressure on the family in terms of caring responsibilities and arrangements that they have to make. We must be doing more to ensure that cases like this cannot continue to be the norm. We can't shrug our shoulders. Every child in Scotland deserves a chance to fulfil their potential. And it is the responsibility of this government to ensure that our schools and teachers have the resources they need to be able to do that. The government's been in power for 10 years. That's a decade of stewardship over Scotland's education sector, which has saw staff numbers fall and pupil outcomes decline. It's not good enough. All those in Scotland's education sector, presiding officer, deserve much better than the failing efforts of this SNP government.
Thank you. Called Jenny Gilruth to be followed by Bill Bowman. Ms Gilruth, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. And can I remind members I'm the parliamentary liaison officer to the cabinet secretary. I heard someone's voice when I read the Labour Party's motion today. It wasn't the voices of my registration class chattering away as they began their school day. It wasn't the voice of my primary teacher, Mrs Wood, the sound of which could stop you dead in your tracks. It wasn't the voices of the young apprentices I had the fortune to meet at Diageo in Leven on Monday. No, presiding officer, it was the ominous voice of that character you might associate... I can't hear myself. You might associate with Hogmanay. Mr Happy himself, and no, I'm not talking about Iain Gray. It was, of course, the Reverend I.M. Jolly. Hello. What sort of year have you had? Has it been happy for you? Did something wonderful happen to you? Well, we've had a record number of advanced hire passes. 4 out of 10 students from Scotland's most deprived areas left school with at least one hire or equivalent, and over 90% of school leavers are now going on to a positive destination. I'd say it wasn't too bad. But, presiding officer, far from it be it for me to be accused of blind party loyalty when it comes to the challenges we undoubtedly face in education. So as any good teacher would do, I try to find an area, any area, of today's depressingly predictable Labour motion which I could agree on, or at least give an ounce of cognizance to. Labour state that the Parliament notes the evidence submitted to the Education and Skills Committee that many teachers have lost confidence in Education Scotland and the SQA. And that part of today's motion I find hard to disagree with. Some teachers have lost faith in these organisations. We know that through the work of the Education Committee. I know that from working in our schools. But it should therefore be incumbent upon every party and every MSP in this place to ensure that trust is restored. And in terms of the OECD results, yes, we know that we're not good enough at the moment. No one on these benches has denied that. But the data provided by the OECD has provided us with a catalyst in terms of the government's education reforms. Yes, I give way to that.
Iain Gray.
Ms Gorris makes a perfectly fair point that we need to regain trust in the SQA and Education Scotland. I made at least two suggestions how Education Scotland could be reorganised in order to try and do that. Could she tell me what she thinks the Scottish Government should do?
Jenny Gilruth.
What I think the Scottish Government should do, well, I thank Iain Gray for that intervention. In terms of where we go from here, I'm going to discuss some of the issues I came up against in the classroom in terms of the organisation of those structures. And actually, I think it's really important that we look at the rhetoric of what Labour-run authorities do on the ground. It is a narrative which necessitates radical reform. And so for today's motion, then to leap to the assertion that this government's stewardship of education is failing teachers, parents and pupils is simply beyond parody. In the response to the governance review, all authorities were asked the question, I'd like to make some progress, thank you. What changes to governance arrangements are required to support decisions about children's learning and school life being taken at school level? Here's what Labour-led Fife Council had to say. The review paper states that the wish to see more decisions about school life being driven by schools themselves, starting with the presumption that schools, decisions about children's learning and school life should be taken at a school level. However, there is no identification of what decisions about school life are not currently driven by schools. Therefore, it is not possible to identify at a local level what changes to governance arrangements are required. Presiding Officer, let me declare an interest as a former principal teacher who worked for Fife Council. And let me tell you which decisions about school life are not currently driven by schools in that authority. First of all, resources. Procurement practice in Fife schools mean that staff have to purchase textbooks and jotters through a predetermined provider. It does not matter if you can source those resources cheaply elsewhere, you will pay what the authority has agreed to. I met a head teacher recently who was forced to use her school budget to pay the authority, her own employer, £3,000 to have essential painting work carried out. This head knew that she could have the painting work done more cheaply through a local company, but because of procurement, she was not allowed to do so. Another head teacher in my constituency told me she had to use her school budget to pay for the entire school to have Wi-Fi linked up, whereas across Fife in new schools, Wi-Fi is provided free of charge and her counterparts do not have the cost deducted from their school budget. My office submitted a Freedom of Information request to Fife Council last year focused on this very issue. We asked for details of all spending on procurement by Fife Council annually since 2012 in each primary and secondary school in Fife. The response? The information you have requested is subjected to an exemption in terms of Section 17 of the Freedom of Information Act. Labour note Scottish Government figures which show falling numbers of teachers and support staff, yet across the water in Fife, Labour are currently proposing to cut 100 frontline teaching vacancies. The EIS have called
Pause, sit down, please. I don't want conversations. I know we're all very passionate about this debate, but conversations across the chamber are not helping. Please continue.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The EIS have called the proposals a recipe for disaster, asserting it will increase staff sickness, class sizes, and pile further pressure on the education service. There is an abject disconnect between the rhetoric from Labour in this chamber and the reality in Labour-led councils. Talking of teacher numbers, in November 2014, I had a vacancy in my department. I was not allowed to advertise for a new teacher. Instead, another teacher who was employed by the authority on a four-day contract elsewhere was parachuted into my department from elsewhere. This teacher was employed on a permanent contract with the authority, and Fife Council do this regularly. They move individuals around the schools according to contractual obligations. No cognizance whatsoever is given to pupils in this process. Eventually, a job may be advertised, but usually this is done internally, which does not allow for a wide range of applicants to be sourced nationally, and furthermore, works to protect individuals already employed in the council. Closing the attainment gap? I think not. When it comes to teacher vacancies, Labour-led Fife councils are resolutely focused on job protectionism. Presiding Officer, there is a narrative of resistance to any change running through Labour-led Fife Council's entire response to the governance review, which is absolutely reflective of that presented by today's motion. But the "we've aye done it this way" argument no longer stacks up. In Leavenmouth and Glenrothes today, one in three children live in poverty. The structural way in which education is delivered needs to be questioned. The OECD results have provided the catalyst for a shake-up of Scottish education. Isn't it time the Labour Party got behind improving Scotland's pupils' life chances and really put kids before cuts?
Thank you. I call Bill Bowman to be followed by James Dorn. And Mr Bowman, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To begin with, I would like to thank Iain Gray for bringing forward this very important debate today on education in Scotland. Presiding Officer, I want to put on record my party's thanks to teachers, support staff, and everyone involved in the hard work that is carried out on a daily basis today in our schools. At a time when workloads are increasing, it is imperative to thank them for their continued drive and ambition to ensure that the education of Scottish children is the top priority. But over the past few months, it has become clear that this has not been the top priority of this government. From the falling standards in numeracy and literacy to the fall in teacher numbers, education has taken a back seat. From the meeting of the Education and Skills Committee, it has become evident that Education Scotland and the Scottish Qualifications Authority have lost the respect of many teachers and parents. From surveys and committee submissions, the committee has heard about the steady erosion of trust towards these education agencies from teachers and parents. Take, for example, the treatment of candidates for the SQA exams. I'm sure many of us remember the days of sitting exams, the hours of revision and the trepidation we felt going into the exam halls. Perhaps a few more hours of revision would have reduced my trepidation, but anyway. The Scottish Association of Geography Teachers asked their members about the 2016 higher paper. 54% said it was poor. They said it was possibly the worst ever, nothing like specimen or previous papers. That's not the only subject affected. In recent times, the new higher maths and computing exam papers had errors and were more unlike specimen papers. At one point, a petition was signed by 20,000 pupils demanding the lowering of the pass mark for the National 5 mathematics exam after it contained completely different content compared with previous exam papers. Now, you might expect some teenagers to rebel, and not without a cause, but not in their tens of thousands. Presiding Officer, the situation is worrying. I'm glad in November Mr. Swinney admitted it is intolerable if there are errors in exam papers, but we are still left wondering if more errors will arise in future exams unless action is taken. Unfortunately, it doesn't stop with exam errors. The guidance distributed by the SQA regarding qualifications is lengthy, unclear, and perplexing. The Education Committee heard how complicated it is to access this guidance. One example was that of physics, where 81 pages of guidance are spread over five different documents. This is leaving teachers to drown in a sea of jargon. Now, drown in a sea of jargon are not my words, but the words of Dr. Janet Brown, the chief executive of the SQA. Not only have many teachers been overwhelmed with jargon, but parents too. The National Parent Forum of Scotland was critical about communication and said that it could not take part in the survey about the performance of the SQA because people did not understand it. The survey, that is. So, this has to change. We need clarity when it comes to guidance on national qualifications. We need to ensure that teachers and the SQA are singing from the same hymn sheet. And we need to make sure our school pupils face a consistent, trusted test. They will live with those qualifications for years to come. It is only fair that education agencies treat them with consistency. Our young people should not have to hit a moving target. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, action must be taken to ensure that both Education Scotland and the SQA can rebuild the trust of teachers and parents. Finally, may I reflect on the words of the Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Swinney, when he said that he readily concedes that the world of education is complicated. Well, let's keep it simple. One thing is absolutely clear. He should note the concerns raised in today's debate and set about fixing the problems to get Scottish education back on track. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowman. I call James Dornan to be followed by Ross Greer. Mr. Dornan, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The main thrust of my speech will be around my role as convener of the Education and Skills Committee. However, I'd be slacking my duty as an MSP if I didn't comment on the tone, negativity and defeatism that oozes from the Labour motion. I'm at a loss as to understand why Labour taking this depressing, negative attitude to Scottish education helps pupils, parents or teachers. How does this constant criticism from opposition, that opposition anyway, do anything to encourage teachers in their undoubted challenge to close the attainment gap? And this is just the day after we've seen the best ever figures for destination outcomes and we're once again told by this no longer even opposition party that the chances of our children amounting to anything are slight. Why are they doing this? Because they've nothing left to offer but gloom and doom. They hope by squeezing out any signs of positivity out of politics, people will go back to them. Fat chance. Have they learned nothing in the last 10 years? Local governments also need to be accountable for their role within the education system. Teacher recruitment is the responsibility of local councils and not this government. If Mr. Gray has questions about staff recruitment, then perhaps he should speak to his colleagues and authorities across the country. Absolutely.
Monica Lennon.
I just wonder why every time we hear about the problems in education, it's the fault of local government, but any time anything good happens, it's because of the Scottish Government.
James Dornan. Okay.
That would be a good point if it was factual, but the reality is that the reality is what we're talking about is teacher numbers here, and the responsibility for teacher numbers does not lie with the Scottish Government. The responsibility for teacher numbers lies with the local authority. So, I mean, you're quick, everybody's quick to put the responsibility here, and it should go here where it lies here, but you have to take the responsibility at local government level if that's where it lies. Just like on the occasional point, when you ever get round to it, you should maybe criticise Westminster when it's there that responsibility lies as well. Certainly, Mr. Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
So we know that the SNP government have cut £1.5 billion to local government, and we know from the Accounts Commission report just yesterday that over 70% of services spending by local government is going straight to schools. So will he take responsibility for his government's cuts? Because that's the consequence.
James Dornan.
I'd love to be able to take responsibility for the fact that the funding goes straight to schools. I think I'll give that credit to Mr Swinney. But what we have to recognise is that the figures came out to show that local authorities had huge reserves still. And also the cuts to local authority budgets were exactly in keeping with the cuts to the Scottish Government budget from Westminster. And that is the one level of government that I never hear the Labour Party criticise. And it's always been a mystery to me about why that's the case. And if you're serious about supporting education, we'd have had a different motion today. One which recognises where Scottish education is, but acknowledges that we still face numerous challenges and brings suggestions about how we face up to these challenges. I want to put my convener's hat on now, presiding officer, and I do. Well, the first one was an MSP. I mean, it's nice having two faces for this. It comes in handy for politicians, I've been told before anyway. Others have discussed.
We'll wait and see that, Mr. Dornan. We'll wait and see it.
Others have discussed the review on the bodies beforehand. I now wish to discuss the information that we gathered by the Committee on School Education since the recent inquiry concluded. But before I do that, I'd like to take time to thank the thousands of educators up and down Scotland who've committed their time and careers to giving our children, young people and many adults the best start they can. Educators are more than just teachers, they're often the only constant in the lives of some of our most vulnerable children, and I highly commend anyone who has the courage and the goodwill to enter into the field of education. Parents in Scotland want the best for their children, and it's been my pleasure to be able to meet with many parents who take an active role through many different organisations in the moulding of our education system. I also have had the pleasure to recently visit a joint campus of St Margaret Mary's and St Conville's in Castlemore, which is having a hugely positive impact on the vast majority of both pupils and staff. And this was after, as is very often the case in these, a very shaky start that now everybody can see the benefit of it, although there's clearly still some issues. The committee had a chamber debate on the issues arriving from the evidence from teachers, amongst others, on the 12th of January, and I spoke in detail then in the forms of evidence the committee had undertaken and the issues arising from it, so I refer members to that contribution. We also continue the focus on inclusivity, making sure it hears directly from those with practical experience of school life, and they are the best place to inform its work. For example, through various means, by my calculations, we've taken views from over 200 teachers since the inquiry into SQA, Education Scotland, SFC and SDS. This excludes social media comments received, but includes 5 more focus groups, a school visit, formal evidence taken, and written submissions from teachers on issues such as additional support needs and personal and social education. We also have the results of a survey sent to head teachers on subject choice in the curriculum for excellence senior phase. This number of teachers does not include those that contributed views and correspondence we've received unprompted from teachers' collectives. So far, as convener, I'm delighted with the progress the committee has made in establishing itself as a conduit for the views of children, young people, parents and frontline staff. We're also very mindful of the diverse evidence we hear and the challenge of analysing it to make recommendations to government. And it's worth noting that a theme arising from a number of the recent focus groups is the continued support for the curriculum for excellence. Beyond that theme, as you would expect, when you hear from so many individuals, you hear very different experiences. Each of the focus group and written submissions are reflective of the distinct experiences of different teachers in different settings, teaching different ages of pupil and different subjects. What this evidence also highlights, to me, if we really want to know what's going on in education, is that the committee needs to keep doing what we're doing. We need to keep going out to schools, keep holding focus groups, and gather more and more information to further inform our work. The committee has also agreed to undertake pre-legislative scrutiny in the Education Bill, and of course will lead on the scrutiny of the Bill itself. It's crucial to ensure the best scrutiny that we are informed in our deliberations by all those with something to say. But although we've heard a number of concerns about how we could improve things in different aspects of education, nowhere did I get the sense of doom that the Labour Party motion dragged us down to. So let me finish by thanking all those who have contributed to our work, and encourage you and others we are yet to hear from to contact us with your perspective on school education. Our website has a video on the front page that details all the different ways that you can get in touch. And can I urge everyone in this chamber to accept that, while of course there is much room for improvement, Scottish education is still something we should all be very proud of, and we should all make sure our parents, pupils and teachers hear that message loud and clear.
Thank you. I call Ross Gear, before Joanne Lamont. Ross Gear, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the Labour Party for bringing forward this debate. The SNP government have asked to be judged in this Parliament on their success in education, particularly on closing the attainment gap between the most and least deprived young people. The Scottish Greens focused our opposition business debate on education, and I'm glad that the Labour Party have chosen to do the same. As Liz Smith said, we all agree on the principle of a high-quality education for everyone. The issue is how it can be achieved. And while I'm glad that the Labour Party have brought this issue to the Chamber today, I would have liked to have seen not just the issues, but the solutions contained within their motion. I'm reassured at least that the government amendment has omitted the most controversial aspects of their education policy. It doesn't mention standardised testings or the deeply unnecessary education governance review. I believe that this Parliament remains completely unconvinced by the focus on governance and structure, when the issues are clearly policy, delivery and resource. Following the concerns raised by teachers, parents and others, the government should consider whether this review will be a costly and time-consuming effort which addresses a question entirely different to the one being asked by so many. Where are the resources? Where are the staff that used to be there? An as yet abstract level of regional governance won't resolve that issue. The other major component of the government agenda that the Greens do not believe addresses the major issues in education is the introduction of standardised assessments, or the expansion of standardised assessments. There simply isn't the evidence to suggest that these assessments of six-year-olds are needed. What teachers need is the time and resource to support their pupils. When not overstretched and overworked by the loss of colleagues and resources, they know their pupils as individuals, and they can support their individual needs. The approach of standardised assessments, to me, runs counter to the principles of curriculum for excellence, and the Greens will continue to oppose its expansion. It is easy to criticise, though, and I've done plenty of that in the Education Committee, including this morning. But we all have a duty to come forward with solutions. And, Presiding Officer, in the unselected Green Amendment, we outline specific proposals to improve education and the lives of our young people. We ask that the Cabinet Secretary takes these on board. I welcome the Scottish Government's movement on LGBTI inclusion in schools, but it's not yet enough. 9 in 10 LGBTI young people have experienced bullying in schools based on who they are. Many have even been driven to self-harm or attempted suicide. And despite new guidance in 2014, a culture of intolerance has persisted. The Education and Skills Committee received damning evidence of this in our recent roundtable. And we cannot continue to act as if nothing is wrong, or expect guidance documents alone to resolve the issue. It would be a welcome first step today if the Scottish Government could at least agree to take on the two proposals for inclusive education from the TIE campaign that were outlined in the Green Amendment. Explicitly recording all incidents of homophobic, biphobic and transphobic bullying in schools is vital. We look forward to ensuring the Scottish Government and our local councils live up to their responsibility to LGBTI young people in this area. And proper training for teachers on these issues is also an essential step forward. It will finally undo the legacy of Section 28, which we found still looms large over many schools. By ensuring that LGBTI issues are addressed in both initial teacher education and in free to access further training, we can take a meaningful step towards inclusive education for all of our young people. Yes.
Jeremy Balfour.
For allowing me to intervene, would you agree that the same training is also required for the other protected areas such as disability, race and gender, and we should not put one above the other, but all of them should be looked as a whole?
Ross Greer.
I agree absolutely that all teachers require training on all issues of protected characteristics. I would take an intersectional approach to this to all oppressed and minority groups, and indeed I'll cover this later on in the speech. But with the majority of MSPs now signed up to the TIE campaign's pledge, I'm optimistic that we will collectively ensure further progress towards genuinely inclusive education in this Parliament, because for LGBT young people in particular, this is a pressing issue. They cannot afford for us to wait. But the government must also ensure that all new teachers receive proper training on additional support needs. 1 in 4 pupils in Scottish schools have an additional support need. And as the definition has become broader, the training, the resources, and the specialist teachers have not kept pace. Indeed, the number of teachers has gone backwards. 1 in 7 additional support needs teachers has been cut since 2010. At the Education and Skills Committee's roundtable on ASN last week, we heard how teachers and pupils are not adequately supported, including the damning evidence of a member of staff being directed to watch The Big Bang Theory to better understand Asperger's syndrome. Whilst we shouldn't read too much into specific incident, it is indicative of the result of budget cuts and the erosion of ASN training. Again, I'm sure this Parliament will hold the government to account if they fail to ensure that more training and more accessible training is available for teachers.
And finally, the Green Amendment called for the Scottish Government to poverty-proof our schools. The EIS has run a great campaign on this issue, highlighting what schools can do across a range of issues, from hunger to homework. With one in five children in Scotland living in poverty, schools must be supported in the help that they provide their young people. And whilst I'm disappointed that our amendment was not selected, I would ask the closing speakers from all other parties to respond to what the Greens and what the EIS are calling for. The government has at least acknowledged in their amendment the contribution of budget cuts, teacher workload, and the exceptionally poor performance of some education agencies, including the SQA. And Labour have well laid out the issues faced across the board, though, as I said, the Greens would like to see more solutions coming forward and not just the problems being highlighted. We will continue to propose the solutions that we believe are necessary to provide a high-quality, inclusive education for all of Scotland's young people.
Thank you. Call Joanne Lamont, followed by Jeremy Balfour. Ms Lamont, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I say that I'm very happy to participate in this debate. And first of all, can I say that I recognise the privileged position that Mr Swinney holds as Cabinet Secretary for Education. I would contend the best job in government. And I was a little sorry that it was not Mr Chips we got along today, but Mr Angry. All of us who understand the power of education, who have felt or seen its liberating power in supporting people to achieve their potential, who have watched a child struggling to learn or an adult celebrating learning for the first time, all of us would relish Mr Swinney's job, the chance to make a real difference to Scotland despite its challenges. Can I say, I know the strategy for today is to say, oh, the Labour Party is being negative. Saying it doesn't make it so. It's because of my optimism about Scotland. It's about my optimism of the potential of education to liberate our young people that I insist the Scottish Government focuses on what it could do to make a real difference to people's lives. For as we all know, it can't simply be about caring for education. It's about effective action shaped by an honest understanding of the scale of the problem and an evidence-based approach on what will make a difference, what has been done, and what is going to be done based on will it make a difference to the lives of our young people. And while it is a strategy for this debate to delegate blame, we've had a manifest whataboutery coming from across the chamber. Frankly, members demean themselves if their only job is to delegate blame rather than to look at what the challenges education confront.
Fulton MacGregor.
For taking intervention. Can the member tell me who's to blame for the percentage of pupils of getting achieving higher has gone up from 42% to 60% since 2007? Thanks.
Okay, that well-prepared intervention goes down well, but makes my point for me. This is not simply about who takes credit and who takes blame. It's about how we make sure our education system is fit for purpose. Now, I don't want to lay at John Swinney's door all the woes of the education system over the last 10 years. And indeed, as a backbencher, long before that, I was willing to take on my own government in what they were doing, my own local authority in what they were doing. I only wish that those who can give voice to criticisms of local government on the backbenches might find a voice occasionally to take on their own front bench. We know that John Swinney has only been doing this job since last May, but there is no doubt that his decisions as finance minister to cut local government budgets and disproportionately cut college budgets now make his job a great deal more difficult. And there are massive challenges. As has been heard, I recommend to the Chamber the measured and thoughtful report by the Education Skills Committee, unanimously agreed, which seeks to address the grave anxiety that our education agencies, in particular the SQA and Education Scotland, are creating. It is crash TV in an attempt to give people confidence and only throwing up more and more questions about what's happening in our schools. And there is an issue about confidence for our teaching and other staff. This report was in part shaped by the evidence of teachers, an overwhelming, heartfelt response, giving voice to their frustrations at what they were expected to do, their professional frustration at what was happening. There is something serious going on, and if this Parliament is serious about being rooted in the real world, they need to listen to that. And the Cabinet Secretary approach to that report, the ministerial equivalent of nothing to see here, just move on. Sadly, rather than reflecting on what the report says, the Cabinet Secretary settled for what is easy. Faux outrage in this debate, rather than fierce determination to understand what is being said. He throws up a straw man or perhaps a straw person on International Women's Day. Well, of course, the evidence is not a balanced enough sample. But we know that what these responses said chimed with every bit of evidence we have heard across the board. And it will not do to belittle or impugn the motives of those raising concerns. What an irony that this side of the chamber is accused of talking down teaching at the very time as the government comes after those teachers who dare to raise their voices to say that there are problems. The truth is, in response to criticism, the Scottish Government has not opened up its thinking to what is possible
in
education.
She's not giving me a cabinet.
Let me finish this point. Let me finish this point. The truth is...
Point of order.
On a point of order, Presiding Officer, Joanne Lambert has made a very serious allegation about the behaviour of government ministers that we would somehow go after teachers for what they said in their response. And I want the opportunity to ask Joanne Lambert to withdraw that or to substantiate with evidence, because it's a very serious allegation of the conduct of ministers.
Well, first of all, it's a point of debate, it's not a point of order. You've put your comments on the record. Just continue, please, Ms. Lambert.
I'm happy to withdraw those comments if that is how they've been interpreted. I made a simple point that we're accused of talking down teaching at the same time as when teachers raise their voices in this report, it is suggested their motives are because they have other axes to grind. That is a fact of the matter. But the fact of the matter is the Scottish Government has not opened up its thinking to what is possible in education policy. It has settled for lines to take. And no matter how good the Cabinet Secretary, the First Minister and the backbenchers parrot them, that is all they are. They are things to do, but they do not add up to the serious, thoughtful, focused approach that is required. So what does the Scottish Government need to do? It needs to stop settling for debating points. It needs to understand how threadbare the additional support needs supports are in our schools. Listen to Enable, NUSUWT and others. Recognise the challenges on numeracy and literacy and address the questions of curriculum for excellence, in particular the needs of National 4 students who, in my view, have been shown a lack of respect as young people, but also understand fully the causes and consequences of barriers to learning. And yes, in the end, it is also about resources too. You cannot condemn local authorities for making cuts when over the last period, this government has consistently targeted local government for those cuts. I hope Jenny Gilruth recognises the irony in what she has said about the impact of cuts in Fife. We need a conversation across this chamber about how we properly invest in education, use those resources effectively, and focus on the needs of young people, because education is the means by which they can achieve their potential.
Thank you. Call Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Claire Adamson. Mr. Balfour, please, a tight 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Since being elected to this Parliament, it has become clear to me and recognised by, I think, everyone, that early years of life are the most important for learning. That's when the foundations for the future are laid, and when we begin moving down the path that will take us through childhood, teenage years, and ultimately into adulthood. And it's good that the Scottish Government states that it's committed to improving and increasing high-quality, flexible early learning and childcare, which is accessible and affordable for all children and families. But education experts repeatedly stress the importance of maintaining a registered teacher workforce in all preschool settings, the added value that that specialist can give to nursery establishments. Indeed, the First Minister herself made a firm commitment when she was recently to make this a top priority of the government, and it was a way to close the attainment gap, and the most effective work has to be done in the earlier years. Despite this, early learning and childcare teachers are down since 2007. In 2007, there were 1,672. Now, a 41% decrease. A significant decrease in nursery teachers affecting all our communities. I would urge the Scottish Government also to end the birthday discrimination rule, where we end up with some children not getting the full care that they are entitled to. In fact, some are getting as much as 400 fewer hours of childcare. Now, we have debated this before. For several years, the Scottish Conservatives have urged the Scottish Government to address this discrimination. And our plea again to this Government is do something now. It is wrong that a child loses out on hundreds of hours of nursery education purely because he or she is born in the wrong month. This discrimination also has a financial impact on families who are missing out on hundreds of pounds of free entitlement and is set to climb further when the increase goes from 16 to 1,040 hours per year in Scotland by 2020. This is not a complex thing to set out, but it should be done with urgency, and I would urge again the Cabinet Secretary and his colleagues to revisit this issue. The other issue that is affecting many children is the lack of flexibility. In 2016, Fair Funding for Our Kids revealed that two-thirds of nursery places are only half-day, which means if you're a working parent, it is completely unsuitable. The report found out that 65% of all nursery places in Scotland were half-days only, and 89% of all council nursery places for 3 to 5-year-olds were half-days only. According to new research by the Family and Childcare Trust in Scotland, this has inflation is busting 4.5% in the last year, and only 1 in 4 councils in Scotland are confident there's enough childcare in their area for every parent that works full-time. The gaps are even bigger for parents who do not work regular office hours, shift workers, etc., where only 1 in 9 councils said that there are enough care available. Unlike England, in Scotland, councils do not have a duty to make sure there's enough childcare in the local area, and I would suggest we need to revisit this urgently. And because of lots of councils only award partnership funding for a year at a time, there have been cases where a child has had to move 5 times to different nurseries in their 3 to 5 year period because of a change in funding and because of a change in relationship. Again, this is distressing for children and parents alike. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, can I turn to additional support needs? We go back to the report of Enable Scotland published at the end of 2016, where inclusive education is still far from the reality of many young people. This includes not just education, but their friends and peers, what happens out with the classroom, and the opportunity to take activities for the whole school day. In addition, the number of pupils identified has increased with lots of different conditions, and I welcome that because there's been a change in the definitions. But can I say, I do think we need to revisit the issue of mainstreaming against those who go to special schools. Yes, mainstreaming should be for the majority of children, but I fear that we have moved too far away from looking at children who do need that extra help they can get in special schools. Too often in the last years, I've spoken to parents and visited different schools, I hear horror stories of bullying, of lack of achievement, because a child has been moved out of a special school into mainstreaming. And again, I think we need to start this debate afresh, look at it again, and take the principle, which I know this government agrees with, that we look at every child, but that makes sure that funding follows that child so that it gets the proper education that he or she deserves, and to also make sure that the families around that feel that they are getting the support. Thank you very much.
I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I declare an interest as a board member of the Scottish Schools Education Research Centre, SSERC? Presiding Officer, rarely have I felt so despondent about the debate as I do today about this Labour motion before us. Can I say to the diminished group on my right of the chamber that if parents and pupils, and indeed teachers, believed a word of their negativity, I wouldn't be here as the constituency MSP for Motherwell and Wishaw because I would not be here without their support. And I think the Labour Party strongly needs to reflect on this and their wrong representation of Scottish education this afternoon. In February 2015, the government moved to address the falling teacher numbers. It meant that the councils couldn't keep up the previous amount of teachers that they have. In North Lanarkshire Council, at that budget, they were planning to cut 126 teaching posts. And when the government stepped in to prevent this, Labour leader Jim McCabe said, "A gun is being held to our head by the Scottish Government and it's unacceptable." Presiding officer, that's the reality of Labour councils when it comes to teacher numbers. And despite the bleating, they take the Scottish Government money in North Lanarkshire Council to maintain the teacher numbers. But they are so utterly inept that they couldn't count them properly and had to hand back £713,000 that could be used for the education of people in North Lanarkshire Council and in my constituency. Iain Gray wanted to talk about his own area today, and that's where I want to focus. North Lanarkshire Council not only can't count the teachers, they can't monitor their contracts either. There's an ongoing investigation. That press report has said there's a potential £20 million overspend in contracts. But they come to this chamber today blaming our government for cuts. They should hang their heads in shame. I want to talk about the Pupil Equity Fund in my area. £2,067,600 coming directly to the head teachers in my area. And I will be really keen to see how each head teacher uses this money in my area. The school that's receiving the most is Berryhill Primary School in Craignewk, £140,400, because it is in one of the most deprived areas in Scotland. It's the only school in the area because the Labour Council closed St Matthew's Primary a few years ago against the will of the local people. So there we have Berryhill being supported by this government. What did the Labour Council do? A few months ago, they closed Craignewk Library. Cultural vandalism against one of the poorest areas in our country. And I say again, they should hang their heads in shame. They are also cutting in Mavis Bank School, which is a complex additional support needs school. They are cutting instructors and early learning practitioners to be replaced by classroom assistants who cannot give these young people the one-to-one support they need. And yet they complain to us about support for additional needs students. What the opposition today will not talk about is the £1.4 million of educational maintenance allowance that came to North Lanarkshire Council from this government last year. That money, keeping our young people in education, I'm not taking any interventions, sorry. Or certainly from nowhere will we talk about the £2.8 million of European funding that North Lanarkshire Council received in its budget last year, because goodness knows where that's going to come from after Brexit. They talk about failing our young people. The students of New College Lanarkshire that I welcomed to this Parliament only a few weeks ago, because they had won gold, silver and bronze award at the World Skills Challenge, were certainly not being failed by this government. Their achievements range from music to technical makeup, artistry and to engineering. And they will go on to be part of the 93% of young people around who are going to go to positive destinations, a highest level ever and something that we should all be welcoming. And isn't it good that we accurately count these figures now? Because when Labour was in charge, they were happy to give money to challenge the not in education, training and employment category, give it to schools, and they had no mechanism to follow these children through. But this government, and under Angela Constance as Education Minister, put in the information sharing with the colleges that would allow that to happen. So we actually do have accurate figures on what works now. And what about the £729 million of PFI cost that North Lanarkshire Council is going to incur for their PFI schools. £21.3 million going out of the budget to finance PFI initiatives. The schools built in our area under this government will remain in council control at the end of those contracts. So, Presiding Officer, I want to talk about Thornley Primary, one of the schools who get the pupil equity fund. They gave evidence here. Or St Aidan's High School, another pupil equity fund school, who were finalists in the TESS Awards only a few years ago. Let's get this right. I'll work with anyone who's serious about improving education in Scotland.
Call Tavish Scott, to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Now, it should be no surprise to the Deputy First Minister that when he studied the ducks board at the Anson High School in Lerwick, he only found one Scot on it, and he was right. It wasn't me, it was my sister. But I also say every time I go to Inverness Royal Academy in Inverness to see how my son is doing in his hires, I see Mr Gray's name at the top of the ducks board. So greatness is vested on many, but just not me in this particular occasion. Now, the other thing that John Swinney did this morning at committee was he accused me of brandishing a survey or a paper in a previous debate, and he got the better of me, I must confess. So I thought, what am I going to do today? And I thought, well, the Herald gives me another opportunity to brandish a piece of paper, because here today, after all, it has produced a league table. Yes, a league table. There hasn't been quite so much discussion of that. But I want to make a couple of serious points, actually, about what today in the Herald is actually some very thoughtful coverage of education in Scotland. Because what that league table does demonstrate is something very straightforward, that children from poorer backgrounds trail behind kids with well-off families. The attainment gap is wide and shows few signs of closing. In the top 50 Scottish schools identified using Scottish Government data today, 7 of the top 10 schools have either none or fewer than 5 pupils from deprived backgrounds. Now, in fairness, most Scottish schools have a much greater social mix. But because deprivation has such a significant impact on exam performance, the tables reflect that schools serving middle-class areas do better. So where now? There has been political consensus around curriculum for excellence, but politics has delivered cuts to school budgets over many years. As teachers in Shetland said to me at the weekend, classroom assistance numbers are down, there is less learning support, and we have increased class sizes. So Scotland has implemented a new approach to teaching since 2011, and at the same time has seen cuts to the money available to our schools. And on top of that, of course, it is important to recognise that the exam system has changed as well. So it is no wonder that the implementation of curriculum for excellence has been so challenging. The results are worrying. They have been well rehearsed this afternoon already, and I will not add to that. So what is to be the response to all that? Now, the Deputy First Minister is reading the responses to his review over who does what. He has introduced a direct but as yet limited funding stream to head teachers based on free school meals. But that means, in effect, that for schools, the majority of funding still arrives via local government. I want to suggest that education needs, more than anything, is a change to the culture of conformity. Education does need cultural change. Culture, as many argue, trumps structure. The very core of curriculum for excellence is to open out teaching, an engaged and an enhanced profession, to provide a broad landscape for schools and to encourage innovation. Yet the opposite is more often what we find. If Scotland is to hold on to curriculum for excellence and to make it work and to deliver success for pupils and young people, we must be honest about what has happened since 2011 and learn from it. It was implemented by a government board who, as James Dornan's committee discovered, took no collective responsibility for what was happening, listened but did not act on teacher workload pressures, and acquiesced while 20,000 pages of ever-changing guidance flooded the inboxes of every teacher in the country. It was not the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board, stuffed with the educational good and great, who have finally began to limit the endless centrally produced teacher guidance. I want to give credit to John Swinney for addressing that point since last year. So the government's review should start at the top with the Deputy First Minister's own department and his agencies. I suggest he should separate school inspection from policy advice to ministers. That should be in Mr. Swinney's office. It's logically placed there. An overall strategic plan is rightly Mr. Swinney's responsibility. The philosophy of curriculum for excellence is to trust teachers. Let us prove it by doing it. Trust teacher judgment, trust teachers to deliver the very strategic plan the government want to introduce. So Mr. Swinney should be clear about his national improvement plan. It should deliver results in areas where Scotland faces real attainment challenges. But it also should recognise that the top 50 schools in the Herald today don't need lots more guidance. They are delivering for pupils already. One size does not fit all, just as it is a failed philosophy across the whole public sector. Education Scotland has not worked, and the SQA cannot be an arm of government, a regulator of exams, and a monopoly service provider all at the same time. So change needs to happen. Cultural reform, above all, must be about schools. Now, today's Herald features the Vale of Leven Academy, a school with high deprivation areas and therefore a real social mix of pupils. But their attainment challenge has absolutely improved. The higher pass rate there has risen from 67 to 71% in just 4 years. And lots of things are detailed today which illustrate why. And a big well done to head teacher Paul Darrick and his staff for that. Scottish education needs innovation at the school level and an end to conformity, supporting real school leadership, the sharing of good practice, school clusters, yes, primaries linked to secondary, schools needing to be closer to colleges, to business, and indeed to work. Now, the Northern Alliance in the north of the country is leading on that and more to come. So instead of imposing everything from the top, let us look at how schools can be given much more flexibility within Curriculum for Excellence and many more different ways of doing things, such as Jim McCall's Technical School in Glasgow on engineering and on plumbing and in many other areas. The future has to be better, Presiding Officer. Let me finish with this. In a world of alternative facts, young people need the skills to sort out truth from lies, where ignorance is not bliss, where experts do matter and can make the difference, where tolerance of others is important and valued, where a moral compass and an open mind has never been more vital in the world we now live in.
I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Educators and others who work in schools and colleges across Scotland will rightly be angry at the wording of the Labour motion today and their apparent keenness to use our schools as a tool to attack the SNP. Clearly, there are improvements to be made in our education system, as has been acknowledged by the Cabinet Secretary, but Labour's constant attack on teachers and classroom assistants are shameful, and their continued failure to recognise the good work that's been done in our schools is having the same demoralising effect on our teachers as their continued attacks on our doctors and nurses in the NHS. So let's look at the actual facts, as has already been mentioned by others. The percentage of pupils who have achieved at least one qualification at higher level or equivalent has significantly increased since 2007. 42% of pupils were achieving this at that point. Now it's over 60%. And I have to say, I know Joanne Lamont's left the chamber, but I do resent her accusation earlier when she took an intervention from me that was a planted question, that I wasn't somehow able to come up with my own question. It's clear to see that there have been improvements since SNP took office in 2007, which have had a positive impact on education in Scotland. It's great to see our fantastic teachers' hard work paying off, and it just shows how talented our youngsters are. The commitment for continually improving standards in our schools and ensuring that our young people have the opportunities to go into work, education or training is reflected in the figures showing the percentage of our young people reaching positive destinations, again, as others have already mentioned. In North Lanarkshire, the percentage of school leavers in a positive destination has risen from below 88% in 2011-12 to over 92% last year. I am confident in saying that schools across North Lanarkshire and my constituency of Coatbridge and Crichton are really reaping the benefits of this Scottish Government's commitment to education. We can now see excellent progress in aiding our young people in having the best possible chances in life. And I'm delighted to see 66% of school leavers in North Lanarkshire now going on to further or higher education and 22% of school leavers in employment. And for my own constituency of Coatbridge and Crichton, the statistics are even better, with 91% of high school leavers achieving a positive destination, which is something to take pride in while continuing to work to increase the amount of young people achieving this. I had the pleasure of leading a debate on apprenticeships last week, And it is SNP's extra investment and focus over this last decade into apprenticeships that has ensured our young people are equipped with necessary skills to ensure skill gaps are met and our industries can flourish, while giving our young people the skills they need to be at the forefront of our economy and jobs market. Because at the end of the day, college and university isn't for everyone. And that is why it's important to offer opportunities such as apprenticeships to young people to ensure they have the skills to take them forward in life. We should be celebrating the fact that Scotland has the second lowest youth unemployment in the EU, and this demonstrates that we're taking positive steps in the right direction by investing in modern apprenticeships. During that debate last week, I highlighted the need for more BME young people and young women to be offered apprenticeships, and I think this is worth highlighting again, given today is International Women's Day and the excellent debate that was held here yesterday. Improving literacy is a key priority nationally and should be a key aim within North Lanarkshire. We know that improving literacy will help close the attainment gap and improve the life chances of our young people. And I had the privilege of attending my old high school, Coatbridge High, for the Literacy Festival recently, accompanying the Deputy First Minister. It was a two-day event organised by the school's literacy group, which allowed every pupil and department in the school to benefit from a wide array of workshops and interactive activities. The festival offered our young people the opportunity to experience an exciting range of speakers from across the expressive arts, allowing students to experience the rich diversity of the literacy world in their own school. And that's something that's innovative, that's happening locally to benefit pupils. And when I went to that school there, there's no doom and gloom then. Teachers getting on with it, wanting to find ways to help pupils excel. As the Cabinet Secretary has said, we recognise that there are challenges. That is obvious. But this party is committed to closing the attainment gap. In my own local authority, North Lanarkshire, as Claire Adamson has mentioned, schools will benefit from almost £9 million as part of the Scottish Government's drive to improve standards in schools. Broken down, this means 120 primaries and 23 secondaries across North Lanarkshire will receive additional support and funding that is for the teachers and school leaders to decide how best to utilise to close the poverty-related attainment gap. For my own constituency, this means £1.25 million for primary schools and almost £500,000 for secondary schools across Coatbridge and Cryson. And can I just say that two of the secondary schools in my constituency, Coatbridge High, as I mentioned earlier, and St Andrews, have almost half of the pupils at this SIMD level one. And so that will be very welcome money indeed. This funding means children from the poorest backgrounds will receive additional support to stop them having their chances limited by circumstances outside their control. And I've said already, part of my constituency is in the top 10 most deprived areas in the country, and I'm determined to help change that. Closing the poverty-related attainment gap is vital, and I believe that the £120 million Pupil Equity Fund will play a central role in making this goal achievable. And this fund gives assurances to parents, teachers, school leaders and pupils that standards will be driven up and intergenerational cycle of deprivation will be tackled. I can see, Presiding Officer, that I'm running out of time, and I actually had quite a lot more to say about, for instance, nurture groups and play as ways of helping young people learn. But I'll just go straight to conclusion, given that I've not got long left. There is a lot to be proud of in our education system, but undoubtedly there is more to be done. This government is up for the challenge. I am disappointed with Labour's motion today. The generations of people while I was growing up from Coatbridge, across Monklands and the Central Belt, who in the past voted for Labour, would be shocked to learn that this is what they use their valuable debate time as the now third party in this Parliament for. I urge them to start backing our teachers and young people, and instead of constantly seeking to use our teachers and classroom assistants as a tool to criticise the SNP, they should start being constructive and work with this government. Thanks a lot.
I call Miles Briggs to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in today's debate, and I want to support what's been said by Liz Smith and other colleagues. It's a matter of deep regret and alarm that 10 years of SNP government seen a decline in educational standards in Scotland, as evidenced by the PISA survey, and a sense of drift and malaise which has been and has knocked the confidence of a system which used to be looked at as a world leader. This is in stark contrast to the significant attainment improvements over the past decade in other parts of the United Kingdom, and something we should all be concerned about across this Parliament. As a Lothian MSP, I'm acutely aware of the concerns of so many parents in my constituency about educational standards and about the reduction in teacher and support numbers. At portfolio questions earlier today, I highlighted the number of support staff working in secondary schools in Edinburgh and the fact that that's decreased by almost a fifth since 2010. One of the greatest falls anywhere in Scotland. I'm told we had to blame SNP councillors running Edinburgh City Council, and that's something I'll make sure we do in May at the council elections. But other written answers I've received from this government indicate many additional and worrying staffing declines across a range of indicators. The number of teachers working in Edinburgh who have additional support needs for learning as their main subject has declined from 166 in 2007 to 120 in 2016. Within this data, the number of additional support staff in education in Edinburgh's primary schools has fallen to just 27, down from 63 in 2007, and in Edinburgh secondary schools, it had declined from 70 to 44. West Lothian Council's seen a similar decline in additional support for learning teachers from 92 to 62 in that same period of time. And the number of centrally employed teachers with additional support needs for learning as their main subject in Edinburgh and both West Lothian has also declined. As Monica Lennon said earlier, across Scotland as a whole, the number of additional support needs teachers has fallen to 2,896, down from over 3,400 just in 2009. Yet at the same time, there's been an overall increase of 44% since 2012 in the number of pupils with additional support needs, with one in four Scottish pupils now requiring additional support. The Scottish Government makes much of its commitment to reducing the attainment gap, and that's something I think we would all welcome, but it's difficult to see how this is ever going to be achieved on the ground if school support staff and additional support for learning teachers in our schools continue to be cut back so severely. The support for learning staff play a critical role in supporting pupils who may be struggling at school, and their absence piles on the pressures to mainstream teachers. And this is something ministers I really do think need to look to address with our Scottish councils. The inspection regime is also of vital importance in terms of assessing how our schools are performing and what improvements and requirements are needed at a school level. Again, it's genuinely concerning that the number of school inspections has fallen significantly since 2012 at primary school and preschool level, as well as secondary school, but it's actually specifically that fall and severe fall in the number of preschool level inspections where I think it's important and that we look at that and how actually we are getting early education right. And I believe ministers need to urgently look at how they're reversing that trend. Before closing, Presiding Officer, I wanted to also raise a specific school building issue of concern to local parents within Edinburgh. And that is specifically with regards to Liberton High School, because this is one of the last schools now in need of upgrading and replacement. It's a great school and has a strong and effective parent council, but they want to see the refurbishment and investment to ensure that building offers the best learning environment for children and is truly fit for purpose. And I think we need to look at how this has actually been taken forward over the next 5 years of this parliament. It's, like I said, one of the last secondary schools in Edinburgh City Council in need of replacement. And in the spirit of consensus, I hope the Cabinet Secretary will agree to meet with me, the Parent Council and Edinburgh City Council to look at how we can take this forward, as it's a vital investment in our young people in the south of the city. To conclude, Presiding Officer, today's debate is vitally important. Education is fundamental to individual success across Scotland, the success of our society and our economy. And the SNP's stewardship of our education system for the past decade has indeed let down parents, teachers and pupils. The government's review of governance is a great opportunity to change things for the better, and ministers must not let this opportunity pass. The new education bill can and must deliver our schools for our schools to ensure that we empower them and that there's a relentless focus on standards and attainment so that Scotland can once again begin to regain its place as a world leader in education. And I would close with these remarks that, like in health debates, which I take part in this Parliament on a regular basis, and listening to Fulton MacGregor's comments, I think there's a really important thing we need to consider across our parties, and it's this, that our Scottish education system doesn't depend on the SNP, it depends on the teachers and support staff who deliver education day in, day out. And I think it's time SNP ministers started to understand that.
I call Gillian Martin to be followed by Jenny Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A few weeks ago, as a member of the Education Committee, I joined a group of teachers from a range of primary schools in this place to discuss issues that they face freely and confidentially. In the group, there was a mix of new teachers, very experienced teachers, teachers in promoted posts, and at least one recently qualified teacher in his probationary year. What struck me the most about this meeting was the absolute dedication and passion that those teachers had for the attainment and welfare of their pupils. Many of the teachers taught in schools in areas of extreme poverty and deprivation, and over the 2 hours of our meeting, it became very apparent that the single factor was the main hurdle they faced when working tremendously hard to get our children to achieve and learn. We had a very wide discussion of the challenges faced in certain schools and the associated expansion of the role of teachers to include social worker. One teacher told us that she, as the deputy head, often is the person who gets the children out of bed, clothes and feeds them, and takes them to school. She's actually up early, chapping doors to get the kids up and into school. They all said that the majority of issues that children that children had that impeded their learning and put considerable strain on the teaching staff were things that happened out with school and were issues that the children stemmed from their early years. There was huge support for the 1,140 hours of free childcare from a number of the teachers as a good way to target developmental issues at an early stage. Everyone present recognised the value of this in potentially alleviating some of the issues that those children face. I come from a family of teachers, and those teachers' words reminded me very much of my brother-in-law, who trained as a primary teacher and worked initially in a deprived area of Aberdeen City, and later went on to work in a specialised school for children with extreme behavioural issues. And he's now deployed back into primaries in the city as a behavioural expert. When he was a primary teacher, I remember that they had a real problem with actually getting kids to the school gates in the morning, and many of the kids who did make it were making their own way there. A very high proportion of those children would also have their breakfast at school, as there was no breakfast at home. One of the teachers started going in early to play football with the kids before school as an incentive to get more kids to come in. It worked. These were children who often had no leisure interaction with any family members, and the incentive of a game of footy before they went into the breakfast club was something that the kids looked forward to, and would be the difference of staying at home between staying at home and going to school. After this meeting, I was left in no doubt of three things. That the Scottish Government's increase in childcare provisions is a hugely important step in tackling educational and developmental issues stemming from poverty and deprivation. And the renewed focus on tackling neglect is also hugely important. I also found that giving head teachers the autonomy to spend extra funding in their school through the attainment fund so that they can target specific issues that their pupils and teachers face is absolutely the right thing to do. Whether that be in additional support for learning, extra classroom assistance, or something as fundamental as having a fully funded breakfast club. Schools have differing needs, and head teachers know those needs. And the third, and possibly the most important thing, was this. I know that tackling poverty is a fundamental priority of the Scottish Government. And we should all be asking for more welfare powers to be devolved to the Scottish Parliament. Because tackling poverty is not a priority of the UK Government. And their benefits and sanctions regime, I've actually had my time cut, so I'm not going to take any interventions if you don't mind. I usually do, so sorry. Because tackling poverty is not a priority of the UK Government, and their benefits and sanctions regime keeps people in poverty, drives people into poverty, and will perpetuate the circle of poverty, which cannot stand. Children cannot attain when they are hungry and neglected, and schools cannot undo the effect of endemic poverty. As for teacher numbers, I'm lucky to represent part of a local authority area which has a great administration who put together a budget that protected teacher numbers. And credit where it's due, alongside the SNP co-leader Richard Thompson sits the Labour co-leader Alison Everson. We can work together. And they work together, and when they put forward their budget, the alternative budget put forward to them by the Tory and Lib Dem opposition wanted to cut nearly £8 million to the education budget. And before I sit down, I want to say this. Mr Gray wouldn't take an intervention from me, so I've put it into my speech. You quoted an awful lot of people in your speech.
And I had a quote for you from one of your party members, Liz Cameron, the executive member for Children, Young People and Lifelong Learning in Glasgow City. And she was in the Evening Times last night talking about the achievements of Glasgow City pupils. And I'm going to read out her quote. Over the last 10 years, more young people are staying in school. As a result, they have more qualifications and skills and meet more positive destinations. The increase in their staying on rates for S5 and 6 has risen 45% in 2006 to almost 70% of pupils, and it's clearly reaping the benefits for Glasgow's young people. So, who do we give the credit for that? Exactly, exactly. Do we give it to Glasgow City Council, or do we actually start working together to say, Ms. it doesn't Martin, matter who close. Does it, as long as someone does it?
Can I say at this point that all members should remember to speak through the chair and not to each other? And I call Jenny Mara to be followed by Joan McAlpin. No more than 6 minutes, please, Ms. Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I see it as my job as an elected member on opposition benches to speak truth based on the evidence before me. Whether John Swinney thinks instead we should be celebrating, whether Jenny Gilruth thinks it's miserable, and if Claire Adamson and Fulton McGregor think it's negative, so be it. I will continue to analyse the evidence published by the Scottish Government in front of me and speak truth to the Government about my constituents' concerns. By its own report card, the Scottish Government's funding of education in Dundee is falling and its record on education is not good enough. Let me stress, Presiding Officer, this is by the SNP's own standards, its own targets, its own manifesto commitments, and its own pledge to the people of Dundee. Dundee's schools have suffered more than the average Scottish cuts. Let me give some examples. The SNP has a manifesto commitment to class sizes of 18 for primary 1 to 3 aged pupils. Across Scotland, the SNP have managed to get 12.7% of primary 1 to 3 pupils into classes of this size, just 12.7%. In Dundee, only 2.6% of all children that age learn in a classroom with less than 18 pupils. 2.6%. That's 122 pupils out of 4,500. By anyone's estimates, call me negative, tell me I should be celebrating, but by anyone's estimates, that is a broken promise and a huge failure of government policy. On school spending, Dundee finds itself ranked 30 out of 32 local authorities. Only two councils in Scotland spend less than Dundee on primary school education. And with 1 in 4 children growing up in poverty in our city, we should expect the converse, that more is spent where it is needed, as Keith Dugdale has made the case for. In 2010, Dundee spent over £5,000 per primary school pupil on education. 7 years later, under the SNP government, every pupil in Dundee, primary school pupil, has nearly £900 less spent on them. £4,151 per Dundee pupil, only £99 more than the lowest spend in the whole of Scotland. Now, John Swinney said in his opening remarks that school spending went up in Scotland last year. Mr. Swinney, in some areas it did not in Dundee. And why does the Scottish Government continue to preside over a system that allows the poorest local authorities to cut education spending while more prosperous councils maintain spending? Why will they not look to progressive taxation as the Labour leader has outlined? When we learned a few weeks ago that additional support needs teachers had fallen by 14% across Scotland, it came as no surprise to me that I found that Dundee's cuts to ADS teachers totaled 28%, double the cuts in Dundee schools. And I refute entirely the government's well-worn argument these past few weeks that ADS teachers are no longer as necessary now that ADS is being mainstreamed into classroom teachers' jobs. It always was, and it always will be. ADS teachers gave additional support to the children that needed it, And now that support is much more difficult to come by, as Monica Lennon told the Chamber earlier. I spoke to one ADS teacher who had gone back into classroom teaching because she was being asked to cover classrooms so often and not able to carry out ADS teaching. This was due to teacher shortages in her school. She figured she'd be better with a class of her own. This government has undermined ADS staff and stripped out their resources. We have all heard today the shocking figure that under this government, 4,000 teachers have been stripped out of Scotland's school. In Dundee, since 2010, 114 teachers have gone, a drop of 7.5%. And then we look at the government's own figures on reading and counting published just before Christmas. Mm-hmm. If parents can have expectations of their children's time at school, it is at least that they can read and count. But we find that less than half, Mr. Swinney, of pupils in Dundee are achieving expected levels of numeracy by primary seven. Less than half, when the national average is 68%, and only just more than half, 51%, are achieving expected levels of writing by primary seven. If you tell me this is something to celebrate, yeah, I will get really angry this afternoon, because you cannot disassociate the cuts of your government, the cuts of spending over so many years, the lower pupil spend per pupil in Dundee, with these results. And then you look at the attainment gap, which is writ large over a map of our city. Only 20 to 30% of pupils at Meenas Hill's Gowrie Hill Primary School hit numeracy targets. While if you take the number 73 bus down to Broughty Ferry, we find that 90% of pupils hit their numeracy targets. And the ferry has the only Dundee secondary featured in the Herald's list of top 50 state schools by exam results published today.
You must close, Miss Mallard.
I will. What is SNP Council's answer to this? Close Meenas Hill High School and swallow up into a now overcrowded, bigger school. Presiding Officer, I think these results for Dundee tell a great story about the attainment gap and this government's priority, and they should be dealing with it. Thank you.
The last of the open speeches is Joan McAlpin. I can only allow you 5 minutes, please, Ms. McAlpin.
Yes, okay. I want to start off by just quoting the Scottish Local Government financial statistics for 2015-2016 published last week. I think that they bear quoting again because they show that council spent 2.7% more on education year on year in cash terms and 1.9% more in real terms. So Labour's assertion is simply not true. There's also a contradiction at the heart of Labour's argument in this debate. They claim the SNP is responsible for education, all of our schools, and they blame the government for any perceived failings that they have outlined. But at the same time, they ignore the fact that it's councils who are responsible for schools. But they have acknowledged that councils are responsible for schools. Yes, I will.
Jenny Mara.
I thank the member for giving way. I'd like to remind the member of how the SNP councillor's remarks in Dundee, when they said that the real problem in education is not who runs the school budgets, it's the fact that the budgets are being cut.
Joan McAlpin.
Well, I maybe she didn't hear what I said at the opening of my speech, that the budgets are clearly not being cut. Councils are spending more on education. I think there's... No, I've just taken an intervention. I've only got 5 minutes, sorry. No. I think you can't say on the one hand that the SNP is taking power away from councils in education and on the other hand say that... councils don't have responsibility for education. That just doesn't add up. We've heard a lot today about examples of Labour councils failing to maintain teacher numbers. I know that in my area, in Dumfries and Galloway, they often senior Labour figures on the council regularly complained that they weren't being allowed to cut teacher numbers by Mr Swinney when he was finance secretary. Unfortunately, they did press ahead with cutting the number of additional support needs professionals. That was entirely the Labour council's decision, and myself and others, in particular parents, spoke up about that, but they insisted that they were doing it for sound educational reasons. So again, that is very much a local authority decision that I'm not surprised that Labour would like to distance themselves from. I think it's interesting that, you know, the Scottish public, when they were asked by YouGov last November who they thought should run schools, only 21% of them said that they thought councils should run schools. And I think that's probably to do with the track record of many Labour local authorities around the country cutting teacher numbers. Earlier, when Liz Smith spoke, and what I thought was a more constructive speech than that made by many others in her party, she said that curriculum for excellence should be assessed. I left it too late to intervene in her speech, but the point I wanted to raise with her is that the introduction of standardised assessment is surely a way to do this. And that's another failure at the heart of Labour's argument. Pupils are currently being assessed using a myriad of different methods, and these can't be compared. And we want to see how Curriculum for Excellence is working, and every single party in this parliament supported Curriculum for Excellence. We need to have a standardised picture across the country. And it's interesting that Mr Gray and his colleagues have so much negative to say about league tables, which of course are not going to happen in Scotland, but they're also very keen to quote from the international PISA league tables of the OECD. I acknowledge that the Cabinet Secretary has said that he, you know, is paying attention to the PISA slippage and is acting on the comprehensive advice from the OECD to tackle some of the issues in education. But I think it's probably worth saying that we shouldn't take these PISA tables at face value. Finland, where all the parties in this parliament have praised, Finland has slipped in the PISA rankings. The UK has slipped in some categories. There's a big debate in the United States about their performance, similarly in Australia. So I think it's probably worth taking that into account, that not everybody thinks that these PISA rankings are necessarily the only way that you should judge the success of your education system. I think the way you judge your success or your education system is through outcomes. And I think one of the outcomes that's really important is that Scotland has the second lowest youth unemployment in the whole of Europe. And I think that's a reflection on the what this government has done in terms of education. We also have record levels of advanced higher passes. The second highest level of higher passes on record. And of course, we also have a record number of apprenticeships, showing that there are opportunities for people of all abilities. And that's to do with the hard work of our pupils, our teachers, and it's also to do with the policies of this government. Thank you very much.
Now move to the closing speeches. Very tight in time. I call Ross Thompson. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would like to extend my thanks to Iain Gray and the Labour Party for bringing this debate to the Chamber today. Though I'm sorry to say that this afternoon has been a thoroughly depressing debate. Of course, in no way meaning the members who contributed, but the issues and the concerns and simply the facts of Scottish education today. At one time, Scottish education could have been debated with hope and optimism as a shining beacon of example to the world. As Scots, we hold enormous pride in our great discoveries and innovations such as James Watt's steam engine, Alexander Graham Bell's telephone, John Logie Baird's television, and Alexander Fleming's penicillin. However, where are these future leaders and innovators going to come from when today we've heard from across this chamber about an unfolding crisis of confidence within Scotland's education system? With teachers who have lost confidence in the ability of Scotland's education agencies to deliver, with standards in reading, maths and science falling well behind other nations of the United Kingdom, and in fact we're behind both Estonia and Poland. Those sitting on this side of the chamber are unequivocal that teachers are not to blame for this. Yep. The blame lies with this SNP government, who for 10 years have been asleep at the wheel, whose politics of lethargy have left us with a school system that quite simply isn't working. As my colleague Liz Smith rightly points out, The curriculum for excellence has been implemented and delivered poorly. Scotland's schools can ill afford more feet dragging from this lethargic government. We need urgent and radical reform, real reform, the reform that Liz Smith set out in her opening and that the Scottish Conservatives are absolutely committed to. In summing up this debate, Iain Gray, in opening, waved an SNP press release denouncing English schools. This is symptomatic of the SNP approach. Whether it is serious issues in health or education, the SNP simply want to wash their hands of it, either by talking about England or blaming Brexit, a government void of leadership and responsibility. Mr. Swinney, in his opening, attacked the tone of the Labour motion, yet the tone of his own contribution was defensive and angry. He stated that he refutes the motion. However, I would remind him that the motion opens with notes the evidence submitted to the Education and Skills Committee. Now, I'm not surprised that he wishes to refute this, as it chimes with the nothing to see here response we've had from the Cabinet Secretary to date. And as Joanne Lamont stated rightfully in her own contribution, the committee has received an overwhelmingly heartfelt response from teachers. That's what she said, and that is so true. They have highlighted where challenges are, they've been laid bare, and should not be refuted. Monica Lennon rightfully articulated the challenges faced by councils, ensuring proper support for pupils with ASN, and the lack of resources, and it is a really serious issue. Jenny Gilruth, I have to say, I don't know what voices are in your own head, but the voices I hear are those of teachers and parents who have given overwhelming evidence to the Education Committee, and we should all hear their voices loud and clear. Further, Ms. Gilruth railed against EU procurement rules. She must be one of those six SNP bashful Brexiteers. Bill Bowman talked of the lack of confidence in the SQA and Education Scotland and the importance of rebuilding trust and confidence in teachers and parents. James Dornan, in his contribution, said education is the responsibility of councils and not the Scottish Government. And why aren't you blaming Westminster? Well, if he had said Brexit, he would have had a full house with that one. Ross Greer mentioned very importantly the support for Tai, and I am on record in giving my own support to Tai, and I'm delighted that there's a majority in this Parliament. And as I asked the Cabinet Secretary Committee, we need to see urgency from government and delivering on it. Jeremy Balfour highlighted the inherent unfairness in birthday discrimination, where we have something which, on these benches, we have long opposed. Tavish Scott was absolutely right to raise the serious issue that Scotland's poorest children are nearly 3 years behind children from affluent backgrounds, which is deeply worrying. And we also support that call that Education Scotland cannot be judge and jury, that we need a separation of ministerial advice and inspection. Miles Briggs talked about the worrying staffing declines in Edinburgh. Julian Martin, I would gently remind her that when she talks about cuts, that this government has cut 150,000 part-time college places. Now, that is something that is shameful. Jenny Mara is correct that the government may not want to hear the reality of education on the ground, and that is our job to highlight it and to challenge the government, even when they want to stick their fingers in their ears. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government tell us that education is their defining mission. But from the damning evidence we've heard in today's debate, if this is how the Scottish Government deals with a defining mission, I dread to think about the areas of government which don't gather the defined attention of government ministers. This government's true mission only ever has been and only ever will be their transcending belief in independence. Independence at all costs, even if it costs the potential and opportunity for the next generation. It's time for the Scottish Government to get back to the day job to ensure that all of Scotland's young people have the opportunity they deserve to achieve their full potential. And when the SNP don't, can't or won't stand up for education in Scotland, the Scottish Conservatives will. Thank you.
I call John Swinney. Up to 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Ross Thompson said that I follow the nothing to see here approach to the debate on education, and I don't think in any way that would be a fair characterisation of the approach that I've taken to office since I became the Education Secretary last May, where I have quite openly and honestly come to Parliament and confronted difficulties that we face. And Liz Smith, his colleague sitting next to him, acknowledged that, when I dealt with the PISA results in December, which is why the amendment in my name is, in my view, a balanced assessment of Scottish education. It acknowledges that despite the progress that's been made on improving attainment in Scotland, which are undeniable statistics about the improvement in performance, there remain significant challenges in closing the attainment gap in raising standards for all. I acknowledge the wider challenge that exists within Scottish education, including budget pressures, the wider impacts of poverty on educational opportunity, and the necessity of looking at some of the work which Mr. Greer made mention to this in his comments about the work that the EIS have brought forward on poverty proofing around the impact of poverty on school education. And these will be for Mr. Scott made that point, that that poverty is an undeniably significant factor on education. And I've acknowledged in the amendment the challenges of teacher recruitment, of teacher workload, and I've done a number of things, as Mr. Scott again recognised, to tackle teacher workload in the short period in which I have been the Education Secretary. So I don't think it's a fair characterisation to say that I'm taking a nothing-to-see-here approach, because I'm engaging very directly in the issues and the challenges that are raised with me by the teaching profession, the length and breadth of the country, in my regular and systemic discussions with them. I'll give way to Mr. Gray.
Iain Gray.
I'm grateful to him for giving way on a very specific point. I think he did indeed listen to teachers when it came to workload and unit assessments in National 4, and at the time I was happy to welcome that. There's been some evidence since then that the changes SQA have made to replace those assessments will create as much, if not more, teacher workload, and I wonder if he intends to take any further action.
John Swinney.
I'm very actively addressing that issue, because the consequence, this is a very good illustration of the challenges that I face, that on the one hand, the desire which was made by the professional associations to remove unit assessment from National 5, it causes implications about the borderline candidates between Nat 4 and Nat 5, and there are very real challenges there, but it's a consequence of there being unanimity within the professional associations of wishing there to be a removal of National 5. And I'm trying to address that issue, and I'm trying to address it as effectively as we can. Now, Mr. Greer asked us to address in the summing up the issues that were raised in his unselected amendment, and I've addressed some of those in relation to poverty and poverty proofing already. But I acknowledge, and we had a helpful discussion about this, I thought, at committee this morning, about the importance of addressing additional support for learning needs, recognising the broader needs that young people have. But specifically, the government is committed to working with local authorities and schools to have in place the resources and the support to ensure that every child gets the support that they require. That is an essential part of the commitment of getting it right for every child. And the committee discussion with me this morning recognised and acknowledged the importance of ensuring that was focused on the needs of young people. And equally, the points that are raised in his amendment about the implications for the LGBTI community in Scotland of two things. Of one, making sure that the personal and social education that relates, that is delivered to young people through the health and wellbeing aspect of the curriculum, takes due account and full account of LGBTI issues, but that we also address the issues that involve recording incidents to make sure that we have a due and proper record of the experience of young people so that can be tackled and addressed is an important part, and equipping our teachers with the knowledge through initial teacher education of what can be done to address those circumstances, and I happily give that response to Mr. Greer today. Tavish Scott raised a number of different issues about the issues on the reform of Scottish education, and I thought made a very substantial contribution to the debate about this point. I agree with him that the culture of conformity needs to change, and that we need to have an approach which develops and deploys the flexibility in individual schools to address the needs of young people. That is essentially the question that's posed at the heart of the governance review. And I would point out that the governance review is rather dispatched in the Labour motion as something we shouldn't be doing. But I think, and I'm And I'll be interested to hear what others have got to say about this. I think there is a need for us to look at issues of governance, so I'll therefore be a bit surprised to hear the explanation from the Conservatives of why they will potentially support the Labour motion, given the fact that Liz Smith has just nodded her head when I said there is a need for governance issues to be addressed. Mr Scott made a very important point about the fact that real leadership needs to exist in our schools to be able to deliver quality learning and teaching, and I'm absolutely in agreement with him about that particular point. Now, this has not been, I think, a particularly great debate for Scottish education, and I suppose it was summed up in a sense by the comments that were made by my colleague Gillian Martin in drawing her remarks to a close, where she quoted the convener of the Education Committee of Glasgow City Council, Bailey Liz Cameron, who's a Labour member, and who made comments which Gillian Martin put on the record, which were very positive remarks about improvements in Scottish education over the course of the last 10 years, since 2006. And Gillian Martin asked the question, who's responsible for that? And Iain Gray shouted from a sedentary position, Glasgow City Council. Well, Glasgow City Council cannot at the same time be responsible for the great achievements in Scottish education which have happened while the SNP has been in government, and the SNP government is responsible for all the failures. And I simply put that's why I put forward my amendment in the way that I put it forward, as a balanced assessment of Scottish education, which says there are undeniable improvements and strengths in Scottish education. There are. Nobody can deny them. 30% increase in hires achieved. Highest level of advanced higher qualifications in history. All been achieved. But there are also challenges, problems, issues that need to be addressed. And I want to tell Parliament this afternoon, I'm absolutely determined to address those issues.
I call Daniel Johnson to close the debate until around a minute to five, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Iain Gray opened this debate by stating that the government's track record doesn't begin in 2016 when it comes to education, that it exists within a context and a history, and he's absolutely right, because the government has had a decade in charge of education, and it has a record already. And when you look at the numbers, that record is clear. In 2007, there were 55,000 teachers in Scotland. Now there are fewer than 51,000, a fall of 4,000. In 2007, there were 21,300 support staff. Now there are fewer than 20,200, a fall over 1,000. In 2007, the average primary class size was 22.8. Now it's up to 23.5. Spending on our schools has gone from 5.1 billion to 4.8 billion. And the Sutton Trust report spells very clearly that bright pupils are now falling substantially behind their well-off peers, with a gap of 31 months, a gap that's growing. And alarmingly, in science, maths, reading, Scotland's education system used to be ranked 10th, 11th and 11th in 2006. And now we have slipped, according to the OECD, ranked 19th, 24th and 23rd. So the Scottish Government say that education is their top priority and that they want to be judged on their track record. Well, I say this, that the track record is clear and is not one that is good. So while John Swinney may be relatively new to his job, his government is not. And his reforms, and especially what is needed, largely fall at his door, because it is resourcing and investment that is the key to looking at why we have seen these declines. Now, I think the way that John Swinney opened the debate for the SNP and the government says much about his approach, because he railed against our motion, said it was miserable. But in so doing, he failed to acknowledge the wider problems, that the wider evidence out there, the other opinions, the criticisms which are there. He only sort of pointed to the attainment gap as being the only thing that he would point to as a challenge. And that is the whole problem. Indeed, I think his PLO did a better job of acknowledging some of the issues that they're faced. It was Jenny Gilruth who pointed the lack of faith and confidence from teachers in the SQA, and that there are issues needing to be addressed from the OECD. We heard none of that from John Swinney. Indeed, I think what this debate is about, and I think so eloquently put by Jenny Mara, is about truth. We need to face up to truth and the realities in the education system as we face them. Indeed, I think Liz Smith put it very well. We need to look at the evidence, and the evidence is clear. We simply cannot just dismiss the evidence that the Education Committee has been looking at. We've had well over 600 respondents saying very clear and unequivocal things. And yes, that may not be representative, but the 600 respondents, I think, with the criticisms that are made, I think make a case for investigation. And we cannot ignore the OECD. The OECD, with its PISA study, is an independent, authoritative analysis, and it says a great deal. And let's start with some of the positive things it says. It clearly states that the quality of our teachers in Scotland is good. Just 8%, much lower than any other part of the country, said that staff were inadequately qualified. So this problem is not staff. But when head teachers were surveyed as part of that study, their criticisms are clear. They are saying they are hindered by a lack of assisting staff. They said they were hindered by a lack of teaching staff. They said they were hindered by a lack of educational material like textbooks and IT. So on these measures, a substantial number of head teachers believe education is being hindered by a lack of resource. That's not us saying that. That's head teachers. So when the SNP accuse us of talking education down, when Fulton MacGregor accuses us of attacking teachers and pupils, well, maybe he's suggesting that it's those head teachers are attacking schools and education when they point out the lack of resource that they have access to. It is a nonsense. And when it comes to reform, again, reforms are not new. This government has presided over a decade of reform in our education system. The education system that we have in Scotland is one of this government's making. And so when we hear evidence that those reforms are not working, that they have got issues, that they lack the support and confidence of teaching staff, we have to listen. I think Joanne Lamont was absolutely right. The Education Committee's evidence should be sounding alarm bells loud and clear. They deserve serious and thoughtful response, a serious and thoughtful response which, frankly, has been completely lacking and absent from the government so far. And I think it is a great shame that James Dornan seems to have dialed down the volume when it comes to speaking up for the criticisms and concerns that are evidence laid clear. In the education debate, I think he did a good job of presenting those criticisms in a balanced way. As he said, they raised credible issues. But now he seems far happier to play those down and criticise Labour councils. I'll take Mr. Dornan.
James Dornan.
I don't think I said anything in my contribution today that went against what I said in the speech there. The point I was making was that local authorities have to take responsibility for the things that local authorities are responsible for. And I would have said exactly the same thing if that had been appropriate in the last time.
Yeah, yeah. Likewise, the Scottish Government needs to take responsibility for the things it's responsible for, namely setting the budgets of local authorities up and down this country who run our schools, and 77% of their service spend goes straight to schools. So if he wants to take responsibility, let's take responsibility for that lack of funding. And the reality is we used to speak of breadth as a strength in the Scottish education system, that it's one of our historic strengths as compared to education systems in other parts of the country. But there is serious evidence that that is no longer the case, that we are experiencing narrowing. We're seeing a narrowing in terms of pupil choice. We had evidence from one school which said that the changes brought in by the Scottish Government have restricted pupil choice and progression. We also see narrowing in terms of subject choices. The move to 6 subjects has seen a sharp decline in the number of subjects taken, such as in modern languages, where the number of pupils sitting and passing key modern languages has fallen by almost half. So, and that is also reflected in recent Glasgow Caledonian survey of S6 pupils, where they said that their subject choices had been restricted by timetabling and resource constraints. But I think Ms. Bill Bowman, made a very useful contribution in terms of highlighting the issues with the SQA. He highlighted the confidence from teachers, lack of accuracy in exams, and the sheer volume of guidance. And I think when teachers cannot trust, when there's a lack of confidence in the examination body itself, I think you have to ask yourself just how serious the issues that are facing our education system really are. But let's come to the question of resources, because speaker after speaker from the SNP benches have been very quick to point to councils, to blame them for the issues that are faced in our schools. Claire Adamson James Dornan, Joan McAlpine, all pointing the fingers. But as I said, Joan McAlpine was happy to point the figures that, from the Accounts Commission that referred to last year, but she was a little bit more reticent to point out the fact that that same report showed there has been a £1 billion cut in resource funding to our councils. And that's the reality of the situation that we face. And so while they may be quick to accuse us of attacking schools, of talking education down, what we are calling for is investment in our schools, investment in our local authorities, so they can spend the money that our schools need to do. Because ultimately, Ross Grier, I think, made a very important contribution. And he's right. We do need to look at solutions. And it's a great shame that the Green Amendment was not taken today, because I think it raised some very serious issues around additional support needs and the support that we need in our schools. And I think it is a great shame that all the Cabinet Secretary could do was simply acknowledge those points, because what we really need is action. What we really need is investment. What we need to do is reverse the 1,000 fewer support staff that we have in schools, because that's how we deliver a child-centred education in our schools, is through investment and through the resource, and the way that I think Ross Grier was absolutely right to point out, and as indeed Monica Lennon was right to point out in her speech. So in conclusion, there has been a failure in leadership in our education. John Swinney came to this role and wanted to hit the right ground running, but he was running in the wrong direction. And there could be no surer sign of this than he has so quickly slammed on the brakes of his own reforms. He's had two times of false traction and they've slipped. He's launched a consultation, but he's delayed the response. And the Bill of Education, well, that's delayed too. What we need to focus on is fixing the problems created by him and his colleagues. We've had three previous education ministers who sit with him in the Cabinet who've botched the reforms in curriculum for excellence and the exam system. And the very person who sits around the Cabinet table who is most culpable for the situation our schools find themselves is John Swinney himself, because he was the one who set those 10 budgets under the SNP previous government. And it's those decisions which cut the spending, cut teachers and cut support staff from our schools. So Parliament should send a clear signal to this government, and it should make it clear our judgment on their record, because it's a record of failure in leadership, a record of mismanaged reform, a record of under-resourced education, and a record that has failed our children, parents and teachers. As we vote this evening, we should be judging the government on that record.
That concludes our debate on the Scottish Government Education. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 4485 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4485.
Formally moved.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak against the motion. I therefore put the question to the chamber. The question is that we agree motion 4485. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The next item of business is another business motion. This is 4486, the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Bureau, setting out a timetable at stage one of the Child Poverty Scotland Bill. Again, I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4486.
Moved.
And no member has asked to speak against the motion. I therefore put the question to the chamber that we agree motion 4486. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. We have another item of business. And that's a business motion 4487 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable on stage one of the Contract Third Party Rights Scotland Bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4487.
Moved.
Thank you. And no member has asked to speak against this motion. I therefore put the question to the chamber. The question is that we agree motion 4487. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The next item of business is consideration of six Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move en bloc motions 4334, 4488 and 4489 on the approval of SSIs, motion 4490 on the designation of a lead committee, motion 4491 on Justice Committee meetings, and motion 4492 on referral of an SSI. Thank you. All these questions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. The first question is that Amendment 4456.2 in the name of John Swinney, which seeks to amend the motion 4456 in the name of Iain Gray on the Scottish Government and Education, 10 years of letting down teachers, parents and pupils be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 4456.2 in the name of John Swinney is yes 62, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that motion 4456 in the name of Iain Gray on the Scottish Government and Education be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 4456 in the name of Iain Gray is yes 63, no 62. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. I propose to ask a single question on Parliamentary Bureau motions 4334 and 4488 to 4492. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected. Therefore, the question is that we agree motions 4334 and 4488 to 4492 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. And that concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business in the name of Linda Fabiani. We'll just take a few moments to change seats.